I'm going to speak on patriotism versus jingoism. Shreya, in her introductory remarks, introduced a third category, nationalism. In some ways, nationalism is the mother lode from which patriotism and jingoism emerge. You know, mothers have different kinds of children, and nationalism is the mother lode. And as a modern invention, nationalism begins in the 19th century in the continent of Europe. That's my judgment as a historian. Ideologues may dispute that, but as a historian, I understand modern nationalism to have emerged in the 19th century in Europe, a century that saw the invention in the same continent of the telegraph, the railroad, and electricity. Nationalism is arguably more influential and more complicated in its manifestations than those scientific inventions. Now, the European model of nationalism had some very clear features. In Europe, in different parts of Europe, as the nations that now constitute the European Union came into being, the citizens of a particular territory were united on the basis of an allegiance to a common language, a common religion, and a common enemy. These are the three constitutive elements of European nationalism. So if you read Linda Colley's great book, Britain's Forging the Nation, or you read Eugene Weber's equally outstanding work of historical scholarship, Peasants into Frenchmen, you get a sense of how Britain and France were formed as modern nations. In Britain, English was a unifying force, a single language. So different dialects, Scottish, Welsh, Gaelic, were kind of either suppressed or homogenized in a standard English. Likewise, religion. In England, the Queen is still the head of the Church of England. So the Protestant Church, allegiance to the Protestant Church was very important, which meant that Catholics were second-class citizens, and of course, Jews were actively persecuted. Go across the channel to France, and it's the same process in reverse. French becomes the standard language, imposed on a variety of dialects. Catholics are the dominant community, so Protestants are persecuted, and you hate England. The British hated France, the French hated England. And across the continent, it's a very similar model. In Poland, the Polish language is fundamental to creating a sense of shared citizenship. So nationalism is defined primarily by the language you speak. Everyone must speak the same language. Everyone must be of the same faith. So Catholicism in Poland. In Poland, being a small country, who your enemy was depended on what century. It could be Russia at one point of time. It could be Germany at another point of time. But again, as in France and in England and in other countries across 19th century Europe, nationalism was based as much on language and religion as on the identification of a common enemy against whom the citizens concentrated their energies, their animosities, their hatreds. Now, that's the European model of nationalism. And I say this as a historian, and I hope with a perfectly straight face, that Pakistan is a perfect European nation. Origins of Pakistan lie in the sentiment that Muslims cannot live with Hindus. So religion, unlike in Europe, religion comes before language. But following the creation of Pakistan, language becomes crucial. So in his first speech in Dhaka, Muhammad Ali Jinnah tells the Bengalis of East Pakistan that you have to learn Urdu. And of course, Pakistanis are united by hatred of India. So that is the European model of nationalism adopted by Pakistan, by Israel, and some other countries outside Europe. But the special genius of Indian nationalism is that it did not privilege a single language or a single religion. There were many people who contributed to this innovation. You know, there's a debate about different kind, whether plastic surgery was invented in India. But I can tell you that Indian nationalism was a special kind of distinctive innovation, and it's modern. It's 20th century. It started in the late 19th century but it found its fruition and most compelling elaboration in the early 20th century. And many people contributed, but Mohandas K. Gandhi above all. So in that model of nationalism, the Indian adaptation, invention, some would say distortion, though I say elaboration and sophistication of European model of nationalism, you did not have to subscribe to a single religion. Gandhi always said, when he spoke of his party, the Indian National Congress, that it had had Parsi, Christian, Jain, Muslim, as well as Hindu presidents. And at the level of the everyday life, at the level of relations between citizens too, the Gandhian model of nationalism never privileged a single religion. In this city, he lived and died for Hindu-Muslim harmony. Nor did it privilege a single language. When Gandhi came back from South Africa in 1915, the Congress was already 30 years old. And the Congress was organized on the basis of provincial units. And these were the provinces of British India. So there was a Bombay Presidency Congress, a Madras Presidency Congress, a Bengal Presidency Congress. What Gandhi did was to change the organization of the Congress into linguistic units. So a Karnataka Congress, a Maharashtra Congress, a Gujarati Congress, a Odia Congress, a Tamil Congress, a Kerala Congress, and so on. And in 1920, he promised that when India would become independent, every major linguistic group would have its own province. So nationhood was not identified with a single religion, nor a single language, and finally and most remarkably, not even a single enemy. The great Vietnamese nationalist Ho Chi Minh is reported to have said that if Mahatma Gandhi had been fighting the French, he would have given up non-violence within a week. Now, that's a debatable question. But what is really special about the Gandhian model of nationalism, apart from the fact that it did not privilege a single religion or a single language, is that you did not even have to hate the British to be a good Indian nationalist. And there are many examples of this. Gandhi's friendship with Charles Freer Andrews. His closest friend was an Englishman. You know, if you loved and admired Gandhi, like many of his colleagues did, you called him Bapu or Gandhiji. If you disliked or distrusted Gandhi, like many of his colleagues did, you called him M.K. Gandhi or Mr. Gandhi. Jinnah never called him Mahatma, and the communists never called him Mahatma either. Now, the only person in adult life who called Gandhi Mohan was Charles Freer Andrews. And this went beyond love or affection for an individual Englishman. There's a wonderful story about the great Mumbai patriot Yusuf Meher Ali. You know, there's a Mumbai connection in this room. I mean, there's some people in this room who remember Yusuf Meher Ali, distinguished judges and lawyers sitting in the front row. Yusuf Meher Ali was one of the great forgotten figures of Indian nationalism. He was, someone who may have coined the term Quit India. He went to jail many times. In the 1940s, he was dying of cancer. And in 1946, his friends took him, since there was no proper cancer treatment in Mumbai at that stage, his friends raised money, he was dead, still in his early 40s, to have him treated in New York. And there he met a friend, the brilliant American writer Bertram Wolfe, who tells the story of Yusuf Meher Ali, who he knew for 25 years, suddenly being very gentle and soft towards the British. You know, here is a man who'd been in jail in the 20s, 30s, 40s. He had been harshly treated in jail. He was in a state of physical collapse. In previous meetings with his American friend Bertrand Wolfe, Yusuf Meher Ali had always criticized the British. But in 1946, he suddenly soft and sentimental towards them. So this American asks him, what happened, Yusuf? And Yusuf says, Gandhiji has told us they are now going. So forget all the evil they did. Remember, not only the good they did, but what they can give us. The rule of law, the rule of law, the sense of fair play, the English language. Gandhi did not add the game of cricket, but I would add that too. So this is really a special feature of Indian nationalism, apart from what is well recognized. that unlike Pakistani nationalism, French nationalism, British nationalism, Israeli nationalism, Indian nationalism does not privilege a single religion or a single language, but it also does not privilege even the people who colonized us for 200 years, we did not have to hate them. Now, in 1920, at the time of the non-cooperation movement, the first major nationwide struggle against colonial rule, when across caste, class, gender, and linguistic boundaries, people all across India united in opposition to British rule, and when it's for the first time a mass awakening of the possibilities of Swaraj emerged, Gandhi defined Swaraj beautifully. And I'm going to give you the image by which he defined Swaraj in 1921. It was still many years in the future. But he said, when Swaraj comes, it'll be like a bed or a table with four sturdy posts. And these posts are non-violence, Hindu-Muslim harmony, the abolition of untouchability, and economic self-reliance. Those four pillars will hold up Swaraj. 30 years after Gandhi defined Swaraj, in 1950, the Indian Constitution came into being. And in a more sophisticated, detailed, elaborate, legalistic way, those four pillars of Swaraj were encoded, established, and given legislative and political sanction. So the four pillars of the Constitution were, among the four pillars were, democracy, which means not just free and fair elections, but also freedom of expression, impartial and autonomous institutions. Democracy, the abolition of caste and gender distinctions. I mean, Gandhi did a great deal to abolish caste distinctions, not perhaps enough to abolish gender distinctions, but that became crucial in the Constitution. Religious and linguistic pluralism and economic self-reliance. These were four of the central features of our Constitution. And these are elaborations of the Indian model of nationalism, if not invented by Gandhi, elaborated and given shape by Gandhi. And what is crucial about this model of nationalism, as contrasted to other forms of nationalism, is that it is based on a set of values. It is not based on language, it is not based on religion, and it is not based on a common enemy. It is based on a set of values: democracy, abolition of caste and gender distinctions, religious and linguistic pluralism, and economic self-reliance. And the nation was sought to be united and given shape on the basis of these values. Now, I call this model of nationalism constitutional patriotism. I used this phrase last week in a talk I gave in my hometown, Bengaluru. And a scholar in the audience asked me what was the difference between my use of the term constitutional patriotism and the way in which a certain German philosopher had used the term. And I'm not a particularly well-read man. I derive my concepts from what I see around me and what I study about my country. So I'm going to give you what I understand by constitutional patriotism. And I'm going to outline what I see as the five fundamental features of the founding model of Indian nationalism, of what I've termed constitutional patriotism. Five fundamental features. The first feature is the acknowledgement and appreciation of our inherited and shared diversity, our cultural, social, linguistic, religious, ethnic, ecological diversity. The acknowledgement and appreciation of our inherited and shared diversity. That's the first feature. I had a Tagore quote to illustrate this, but I had several Tagore quotes. The Justice has already given us a wonderful Tagore quote. So I have another Tagore quote I'll save for later. But to illustrate this founding principle of constitutional patriotism, Indian patriotism, the acknowledgement and appreciation of our diversity, I'm not going to give you a Tagore quote, but a quote from a person who was almost in the Tagore League. A person whose bust I have on my table, the great Kannada polymath Kota Shivaram Karanth. Kota Shivaram Karanth wrote, when asked about whether we were an Aryan nation, he wrote, "It is impossible to talk of Indian culture as if it is a monolithic object. Those who speak of Aryan culture do not realize what transformations this Aryan culture has undergone after reaching India." And Karan continued, "Indian culture today is so varied as to be called cultures. The roots of this culture go back to ancient times, and it has developed through contact with many races and many peoples. Hence, among its many ingredients, it is impossible to say surely what is native and what is alien, what is borrowed out of love and what has been imposed by force. Among its many ingredients, it is impossible to say surely what is native and what is alien, what is borrowed out of love and what has been imposed by force. If we view Indian culture thus," concludes Karanth, "we realize there is no place for chauvinism." What this first feature of constitutional patriotism, this acknowledgement and appreciation of our diversity, inherited and shared diversity, means is that no type of Indian is superior or special by language or faith. No type of Indian is superior or special by language or faith. Indianness is defined by the allegiance to the values of the Constitution, not by birth or blood. That's the first feature, founding feature of the Indian model of constitutional patriotism, as understood by a historian, not understood by a constitutional scholar or a lawyer, as understood by a historian. The second founding feature is the recognition of the multiple levels at which patriotism can and must be practiced. Patriotism, like charity, begins at home. It begins in the home by how you treat your children. If you have a boy and a girl, how do you treat them? How do you treat those who may work for you in the home? So it begins at home. It goes out into the street, the locality, the city, the district, the province, and the country. So it operates at different levels, and these levels are complementary. They do not clash. I am a proud resident of Bengaluru, though I'm not Kannada speaking. To be someone of Tamil origin in Bengaluru is akin to being a Gujarati speaker in Mumbai. You think you're from the city. Some people tell you you're not from the city. But my great-grandfather, my grandfather, and my father lived, died, and worked in Bengaluru, and so will I. So I'm a patriot of Bengaluru. I'm also a patriot of my state. Today is the 1st of November, Karnataka Rajyotsava Day. It is the 61st anniversary of my state's founding. And on this day, you will find, I'm not in Bengaluru, you will find auto rickshaw drivers flying the state flag. It's a yellow and red flag. It's not the elites who fly it. It's ordinary Kannadigas. You can take pride in your street, in your locality, in your city, in your state, and your country. These are perfectly complementary, convergence and mutually reinforcing. So that, I think, is the second aspect of patriotism. I'll add a footnote to that. Although patriotism can and must be practiced at multiple levels, although allegiance to a locality, a district, and a province need not and absolutely does not conflict with allegiance to a country, the notion of a world citizen is spurious and false. And I'm going to give you one of the lovely quotes I have, why I think that you cannot be a world citizen. This quote comes from a very great Indian called John Burton Sanderson Haldane. You can tell from his name that he was born Christian. Actually, he was born Scottish. And he spent the first 60 years of his life as a citizen of England and migrated to India in 1956. For a variety of reasons, he became an Indian citizen, and he then was a great professor at the Indian Statistical Institute. Among other things, he was one of the two or three greatest biologists after Darwin, an Indian, and Scottish person who became an Indian in 1956 and died here in 1964. In 1960, there was a profile of Haldane in a famous American science magazine. And in that profile, he was described as a citizen of the world. And Haldane took great offense to that. He said, he wrote to the author of the article, he said, "No doubt I'm in some sense a citizen of the world, but I believe with Thomas Jefferson that one of the chief duties of a citizen is to be a nuisance to the government of his state. As there is no world state, I cannot do this. On the other hand," says Haldane, "I can be and am a nuisance to the government of India, which has the merit of permitting a good deal of criticism, although it reacts to it rather slowly." That's still the case. "I also happen to be proud," Haldane continues, "I also happen to be proud of being a citizen of India, which is a lot more diverse than Europe, let alone the USA, USSR or China, and thus a better model for a possible world organization. It may, of course, break up, but it is a wonderful experiment. So I want to be labeled a citizen of India." Now, these are words much more eloquent than mine, which express the fact that the diversity of India means you can express your citizenship at different levels, which are complementary, not conflicting. That is founding feature number two. Founding feature number three of the Indian model of constitutional patriotism is the recognition that no state, no nation, no religion is perfect or flawless. No state, no nation, no religion is perfect or flawless. In her remarks, Justice Mittal alluded to that, including what we can learn from legal judgments elsewhere. Hinduism is not flawless. Islam is not flawless. India is not flawless. And our Prime Minister is not flawless. Nor our Chief Ministers, who can sometimes be more authoritarian than our Prime Ministers can be. So this is a very important aspect of the model of constitutional patriotism. No state, no nation, no religion, and no leader is flawless. Mahatma Gandhi famously spoke of having committed a Himalayan blunder. You very rarely meet an ordinary Gandhian social activist who's committed an ordinary blunder. So I think this is extremely important. You know, you have to learn from each other. Gandhi again says somewhere in 1938, "No nation can afford to be a frog in the well. We are an interconnected world and we have to see ourselves in the mirror of another. Likewise, we are an imperfect religion." The reason Gandhi had so many interactions with Christian priests and Muslim divines and atheists, there's a lovely book, those of you who are interested in Gandhi, one of the rarest and most special books written about Gandhi is by an Andhra social worker called Gora, G. Ramachandra Rao. It's called An Atheist with Gandhi. So your religion, your country, your state is not, and you yourself are not flawless. You know, that you're continuously in a process of engagement, improvement, eliminating weaknesses. That's feature number three. Feature number four of what I'm calling the Indian model of patriotism is the ability to feel shame at the failures of our nation and state, and the desire and will to correct them. Every true patriot feels shame at the failures of our society and the crimes committed by our state. And this applies at multiple levels. Human rights violations by the police and occasionally by the army. The corruption and corrosion of public institutions, and in everyday life, above all, by the persistence of caste and gender distinctions. The French scholar Louis Dumont, many years ago, called us Indians homo hierarchicus. And certainly, in the way in which, both in scripture and social practice, we have historically discriminated against low castes and women, must bring shame to any sensitive, honest Indian patriot. and must bring in him and her the desire and the will to correct and illuminate those forms of exploitation and discrimination. That's what animated the life and work of Justice Sunanda Bhandare. So don't be in denial that we are perfect. That's point number three. Recognize our failures, our mistakes, our errors, our crimes, and the persistence of forms of discrimination, and work to correct them. That is true patriotism. And finally, true patriotism, in my view, also should have the ability to root yourself in your culture and country while being willing to learn from other cultures and countries. And I'm going to give you a Tagore quote from 1908 to illustrate this. In 1908, Tagore was reacting to certain people in Bengal and India who glorified the past, who thought Hindus had invented everything of worth. Right? And to these romantic nostalgics for a great and glorious past that we Hindus had allegedly enjoyed, which meant, of course, we had nothing to learn from anyone else, Tagore answered, and I'm going to quote his extraordinary words. I mean, these are in English translation. Some of you would have read them in the Bangla, which is probably far even better than the English, but the English is good enough. So let me read out what Tagore says in 1908. If India had been deprived of touch with the West, she would have lacked an element essential for her attainment of perfection. Europe now has her lamp ablaze. We must light our torches at its wick and make a fresh start on the highway of time. That our forefathers 3,000 years ago had finished extracting all that was of value from the universe is not a worthy thought. Tagore says that our forefathers 3,000 years ago had finished extracting all that was value from the universe is not a worthy thought. We are not so unfortunate, nor is the universe so poor. Now, clearly, these remarks apply to other countries around the world. I mean, the Americans think they're a chosen people. I'm glad they've adopted yoga. The British one thought they were chosen people. When they ruled us, they showed utter contempt for our food and our music. You can get decent food and decent Indian music in London now. So likewise, with us, this other quote of Tagore, which I have not been able to find, and maybe a Bengali scholar or a Tagore scholar in the audience can help me, but somewhere else, he says something like this. We must glory in the illumination of a lamp lit anywhere in the world. As human beings, we can glory in the illumination of a lamp lit anywhere in the world. So these are the five founding features of what I'm calling constitutional patriotism. Just to go over them very quickly. The appreciation of our inherited and shared diversity. The recognition of multiple levels at which patriotism can be practiced. The recognition that no nation, state, religion, or leader is flawless. The ability to feel shame at the crimes committed by our state and within our society and the desire to correct them. And the ability to be rooted in one's culture while being willing to learn from other cultures. This old model of constitutional patriotism is on the defensive. Some would say it's in tatters and on the retreat. There's a new model of nationalism that is emerging, that is resurgent, that is ascendant, indeed, that is dominant. What are the features of this new model of nationalism? First, the privileging of a single religion, Hinduism. Second, the privileging of a single language, Hindi. Thirdly, the privileging of a common external enemy, Pakistan. Now, this completely mimics 19th century European nationalism. 19th century European nationalism was reborn in Pakistan in the mid-20th century and is being reborn in India in the early 21st century. Right. Now, but it also has some other features. It's not just the model of nationalism now on the ascendant, now seeking to be dominant. Not merely privileges Hinduism, Hindi, and the hatred of Pakistan, it also has a fourth feature, which is perhaps as or even more disturbing, which is the branding of all critics as anti-national. M.S. Golwalkar, who is the most influential leader of the RSS, who ran the organization from 1978 to 1973, wrote a book called The Bunch of Thoughts, which is a kind of Bible of the RSS. Some months ago, at the invitation of some senior RSS people in Karnataka, I met them, and I'm happy to meet anyone. I meet leftists, rightists, anyone, right? And they presented me Golwalkar's bunch of thoughts, the way a Christian missionary would present you a Bible. So I happened, I've read that book many times, and I've written about it. And in that book, which was published 51 years ago, and is still being handed out, you know, to people you seek to convert to your point of view. In that book, there are three chapters, which are called Internal Threat 1, Muslims, Internal Threat 2, Christians, Internal Threat 3, Communists. Three forms of enemies of the nation: Muslims, Christians, and Communists. Now, I am none of these. I'm not a Muslim, I'm not a Christian, I'm not a communist, but in the eyes of many people, I'm an enemy of the nation regardless. Now, what you have here is a paranoid and punitive form of nationalism. There's a film, recent film, and many of you would have seen, called Newton. And in that film, there's a lovely line which goes, "Ye desh danda jhanda se chalta hai." अभी नहीं चलता है लेकिन लोग चलाना चाहते हैं डंडा और झंडा से. दिस इज अ पैरानॉइड एंड प्यूरिटी फॉर्म ऑफ नेशनलिज्म. नॉट ओनली इज इट पैरोकियल, आइडेंटिफाइंग नेशनलिज्म विद अ सिंगल रिलीजन एंड अ सिंगल लैंग्वेज, इट इज पैरानॉइड अबाउट फॉरेनर्स एंड इट इज प्यूरिटिव अबाउट दोज विद इन हु सीक टू रिवर्ट और रिस्टोर और रिहैबिलिटेट द ओल्डर फॉर्म ऑफ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल पेट्रियटिज्म. नाउ शुड वी कॉल दिस पेट्रियटिज्म और शुड वी कॉल दिस जिंगोइज्म? The dictionary definition of a patriot is a person who loves his or her country, one who is ready to support its freedoms and rights and defend it against enemies or detractors. Notice the order. A patriot is someone who loves his or her country, is ready to support its freedoms and rights, and finally to defend it against enemies or detractors. Consider the dictionary definition of Jingoism. A Jingoist is one who brags of his country's preparedness to fight and advocates or favors a bellicose policy, a blustering or blatant chauvinist. Now, very clear, right? This is what the dictionary says. And it also offers some quotes of the distinction between patriotism and Jingoism. In the words of the Irish philosopher George Berkeley, writing in the 18th century, a patriot is one who heartily wishes the public prosperity and endeavor to promote it. A patriot is one who wishes for the public prosperity, for the prosperity of the aam aadmi, and studies and endeavors to promote it. Now, what is a Jingoist? Gentleman's Magazine, 1881, defining Jingoist. The Jingo is the aggregation of the bully. An individual may be a bully, but in order to create Jingoism, there must be a crowd. An individual may be a bully, the one Jingoistic neta addressing a crowd, the one TV anchor raining metaphorical bombs on our enemies, or on internal enemies too. He is a bully, but those who hear him, appreciate him, clap with him, that aggregation, the crowd, constitutes Jingoism. Another definition of Jingoism from the Pall Mall Gazette of 1885. The essential infamy of Jingoism is its assertion that the first law of its being is that might is right. Patriotism is suffused with love and understanding. Jingoism is motivated by hate and revenge. I've given you the constitutive features of patriotism. The constitutive features of Jingoism, on the other hand, are, firstly, the belief that one's religion, culture, nation, and leader are infallible. Secondly, the demonizing of all critics is anti-national and deshdrohi. And thirdly, the violence and lumpenization on the street by which these ideas are sought to be enacted and imposed. Now, I have given you a perspective which will tell you which side I'm on. But that's not enough. I'm a scholar. I must try and understand why is Jingoism ascendant? And why is patriotism on the retreat? And I'm going to give you four reasons why what I've defined as Jingoism, others call it hyper-patriotism, but why is it so influential, articulate, vocal today, in India today? There are four reasons I urge you to consider. The first reason is the hypocrisy of the left. You know, the Indian left is in power in Tripura and in West Bengal. It's been in Tripura and in Kerala, I beg your pardon. It's been in power in West Bengal in the past. And it also has a great deal of influence in our intellectual life, in our cultural life. Many of our finest writers are Marxists. Many of our greatest scriptwriters, poets, social activists have been Marxists. But the Indian left, and I say this as a historian again, has always loved another country more than India. Now, this goes back, of course, to the 1920s and 30s and 40s, but it has carried on till today. For a long time, it was the Soviet Union. Hence, the support for the British in the Quit India movement. Hence, the launching of an armed insurrection by the CPI against the Indian state 6 weeks after Mahatma Gandhi died, because Stalin had ordered them, right? So it used to be Russia. Then it became China. Some of you are old enough to remember China's chairman is our chairman. Later on, it became Vietnam. Then it became Cuba. There was some even admired Albania. When I was a student in Delhi University in the 1970s, there was a university professor who was a follower of the Albanian model of communism. And just as I have the collected works of Gandhi on my shelf, he then had the collected works of Enver Hoxha. And still later it became Hugo Chavez, who was worshipped in parts of JNU. Now, it's not that you can't love another country. Of course you can't be a world citizen. But as I explained to you, you know, you must love, appreciate, admire those features of other countries that can enable you to realize and fulfill the values, the best values of your own country. I would like Canadian public health. I would like American universities. But when, at the same time, I would like to improve my country. The problem with the American left was not just the worship of another country, the worship of the most brutal forms of dictatorship and dictators in those countries. Hugo Chavez, for those of you who think Narendra Modi is authoritarian, and I'm with you, Hugo Chavez was Narendra Modi on steroids. Right? And Stalin and Mao were two of the greatest mass murderers of the 20th century. I told you I have friends from the RSS. I also have friends from the CPM. And I meet both of them in the same place, Koshi's Parades Cafe in Bengaluru, on separate days, several months apart. But shortly after I met my friends from the RSS, I had a coffee with a very fine historian, Marxist historian, who is a member of the CPM. And I told him, I said, look, why is it that in the annual conferences of the CPM, you have four portraits, none of them are Indian? There are two dead German philosophers, Marx and Engels, and two dead Russian tyrants, Lenin and Stalin. At least have Bhagat Singh. And he said, I will take it to my general secretary and my district committee and so on. No, I hope Bhagat Singh is there next time. Right. So I think the hypocrisies of the left give ammunition to the Jingoists. I mean, the Jingoists have even claimed Bhagat Singh, who was profoundly antithetical to what they stood for or stand for. That's reason number one. Reason number two for the ascendancy of Jingoism is the corruptions of the Congress Party. And how a great party and freedom movement has been reduced to one family. Yesterday was Patel's birthday. And as my distinguished and eminent colleague Gopal Gandhi says, the BJP has been able to misown Patel because the Gandhi disowned Patel. And he's absolutely right. You know, it's shocking how the Congress of Indira Gandhi and Sonia Gandhi named everything after their own family. And it's not just Patel they disowned. Why couldn't the Rajiv Gandhi Sea Link in Worli have been named after a great Maharashtrian congresswoman or congressman? There's an enormous range of choices. There is Tilak, there is Gokhale, there is YB Chavan. How is it that they've ceded even Lal Bahadur Shastri to the Jingoists? In this city 42 years ago, when Pakistan invaded India, Lal Bahadur Shastri gave a speech at the Ram Leela Maidan as Prime Minister, and he said, on my right is Mir Mushtaq Ahmed, who was then President of the Delhi Congress. On my left is Frank Anthony, who was a member of Parliament and a member of the Constituent Assembly. He said, on my right is Mir Mushtaq Ahmed, on my left is Frank Anthony. That is what makes us different from Pakistan. A person like this, when Rahul Gandhi campaigned for the last Uttar Pradesh election, was Shastri mentioned? An extraordinary figure. He laid the foundations of the Green Revolution. He was a person of a conspicuous and total integrity. And he was a constitutional patriot. So I think the corruptions of the Congress, not just financial corruptions, but intellectual and moral corruptions, and particularly the reduction of the history of the great party of our freedom struggle to the history and biography and personal interest of a single family, give ammunition to the Jingoists, just as the anti-patriotism of the left does. The third and fourth reasons to explain or to seek to provisionally explain the rise of Jingoism are not Indian but global. The third is because of what's happening in our neighborhood. The rise of Islamic fundamentalism in Pakistan and Bangladesh. You know, Pakistan started as a Muslim homeland, became an Islamic republic, and become more and more fundamentalist. They started by persecuting Hindus and Christians. Now they persecute Shias, Ahmadiyyas, and everyone. It's a truly nasty place. Bangladesh is not there, but it might get there. The rise of Islamic fundamentalism in Pakistan and Bangladesh again give ammunition to the rise of Hindu fundamentalism in India, because Jingoism and fundamentalism feed off one another. That's within the locality. And the fourth reason, of course, is the global rise of a paranoid and punitive form of nationalism and chauvinism. Brexit, Trump, Marine Le Pen, right-wing movements in Austria, Poland, Hungary, and all over the world. The failures of the left and of the Congress Party have opened up the space for the Hindutva form of Jingoism. And global and regional forms of Jingoism have encouraged it even further. Now I'm going to end with some remarks about Hindutva, which is, as I understand it, the philosophy of the ruling party, and of the which is not ruling just in Delhi, but in many parts of India, and the kind of Jingoism that it has enabled. It claims to be authentically Indian. And those of us who speak in the English language, of course dismissed because we speak in the English language, I'm a Macaulay Putra. Many of you in this room are Macaulay Putris. And in many respects, it talks about being rooted in this country, indigenous. And I'm going to tell you, as a historian, that it is an utterly spurious claim. Hindutva is partly European and partly Middle Eastern. It's partly Christian and partly Muslim. Again, I'm saying this is a completely straight face. I'm going to give you a few facts to document this. The model of nationalism it practices is totally European. One language, one religion, one enemy. That's where 19th century Europe is part of its It's imagination, it's political imagination. The political and social system it wishes to impose, on the other hand, comes from medieval Middle East. In the medieval Middle East, in Medina, Muslim Spain, Ottoman Turkey, Iraq, the political system was based on three kinds of citizens. First-class citizens were certified Muslims who went to mosque every Friday, who believed that the Quran was the word of the God and that there is no prophet but Muhammad. They were the rulers, the generals, and so on and so forth. The second class of citizens, which was given the term Dhimmi, was allocated to Jews and Christians, who are also people of the book, whose prophets the Muslims also revered, except that they had their own and greater prophet. Now, Jews and Christians were called Dhimmis, and Dhimmi literally means protected person. Protected person. Protected by the state, effectively a second-class citizen who has certain rights, but is denied other rights and opportunities. A Jew or a Christian in medieval Turkey or Iraq could practice his profession, could raise his family, could go to the synagogue, but could not become king, advisor, general, vice-chancellor. Now, this is clearly the model by which the Jingoists of today want to impose on the Muslims and Christians of India. The Muslims and Christians of India today will be like the Jews and Christians of medieval Islam. So there is nothing indigenous about this great indigenous philosophy. It's partly European and it's partly Islamic. It will damage us culturally and it will also damage us economically. So there are these two forms of nationalism. Two forms of nationalism, patriotism and jingoism. Patriotism, as I've defined and articulated to you, had certain features which were encoded in the Constitution, which animated not just the freedom struggle, but political and social and legislative life through much of our history as a republic. And that's the reason we are here together. On the other hand, for a variety of reasons, including the failures of its own adherents, the hypocrisies and corruptions of the political parties that claim to carry on this model of constitutional patriotism, you've had the rise of jingoism. And that's the debate, so to say, the battle before us today. It's a battle between a paranoid, punitive, hateful form of nationalism on the one side, and the other, the heritage of the freedom movement and the Indian Constitution. The first party in this battle has a party. The second party in this battle does not have a party. That's my view. And I think many of you would agree with it. Although there is no political vehicle for constitutional patriotism, the patriotism that built, united, and nurtured the best values, best individuals, such as Justice Bhandare, and best institutions in this country, those of us who are constitutional patriots should non-violently, clearly, consistently carry on the struggle for the best values of our constitution every day of our life. Thank you very much.